Welcome to this series of videos on accessibility requirements for public procurement of ICT products and services in Europe, the EN301549 standard. This is the third video. It's sponsored by Microsoft and produced by Funka. My name is Susanna Loren. I'm an accessibility expert and I have a long experience in standardization work. In this video, we are going to take a closer look at the structure of the EN301549 standard. We will look at the different types of requirements it contains, both functional and technical ones. And then we will explain the relationship between the different types of requirements. And finally, what testing criteria there are. But let's start with the overall structure. In standards, chapters are usually called clauses, but to make it a little easier, we have used the word chapter here. The standard begins with some background information, the scope of the standard, and some references and definitions in the first three chapters. In chapter 4, you will find the so-called functional performance statements. This means that the chapter contains explanations on what functionality is required to enable users to locate, identify, and operate functions in the ICT, no matter of their abilities. This is an important chapter. The technical requirements starts in chapter 5, where you will find the generic requirements that goes for all ICT. In chapter 6, you find requirements on ICT with two-way voice communication. In chapter 7, there are requirements on ICT with video capabilities. Chapter 8 contains requirements on hardware, and chapter 9 has requirements on web content. In chapter 10, you have requirements on documents. Chapter 11 has requirements on non-web software. Chapter 12 contains requirements on documentation and support services. And chapter 13 has requirements on relay and emergency services. The standard also has three annexes. Annex A contains the Web Content Accessibility Guidelines 2.0. Annex B gives you information on the relationship between the technical requirements and the functional performance statements and how they work together. Annex C contains information on how to test, which is also called determination of compliance. Now, let's take a closer look at the different chapters. Chapter 4 contains functional performance statements. These statements specify how the solution should cater for different user needs. Chapter 4 is in a sense the core of the EN standard. The users and their different needs are why we work with accessibility. The user needs are also the reason for each of the requirements in this standard. Don't be fooled by the fact that Chapter 4 doesn't include requirements, but just descriptions. The goal of the whole standard is that the users with the varying abilities described in Chapter 4 can use the product or service. If you have problems finding a solution that meets the accessibility requirements, you must assess the implications for the user groups in Chapter 4. That gives you an idea on the impact a specific accessibility issue might have, and that is essential for you to make an initiated decision on what solution to buy. Annex B contains a table mapping the different requirements in the standard with the functional performance statements in Chapter 4. There is also one table mapping success criteria in WCAG with the functional performance statements in Chapter 4. Here you can see for whom each requirement is important. This table is a key instrument for you to make an assessment of the impact different accessibility problems might have for the end user. Now, let's take a quick look at the generic requirements in Chapter 5. Generic requirements cover, among other things, so-called closed functionality. Closed functionality means that the user can't attach specific personal assistive technology, such as a screen reader with headphones, for a person that cannot read text. This could, for example, be in information kiosks and ticket machines. For devices with closed functionality to work for all users, the system must provide the user with ways to interact and perceive information that cater for different user needs. That means that the system in itself must work as assistive technology. To keep the analogy with screen reader and headphones, that would mean that the system should provide sound in some way. But of course, not only sound. Chapter 5 also says that the system should not require users to be able to perform two actions at the same time. There are requirements on biometrics, that is, for example, when you use your finger or eye to verify who you are. This should not be the only way of identifying yourself. And finally, in this chapter, there are also requirements on how to keep information accessible when it is converted. For example, when you have a document in one format and want to save it in another format, all accessibility information, like headings, should be preserved during that conversion. In Chapter 6, there are specific requirements for solutions with two-way voice communication. This could, for example, be a door entry phone, where one person speaks and another one answers, or digital communication, conference, or meeting systems, where many users can speak with each other. Some of the requirements in Chapter 6 cover the ability to use real-time text communication, or RTT, as an alternative way of communication, which is essentially a chat function where you can read the text at the same time as it is being written. The chapter also includes technical requirements for video communication, such as frame rate and resolution during a call. Chapter 7 covers ICT solutions that feature video. The requirements in this chapter specify that the user should be able to get captioning of audio content in synchronized video. That means a video with image and sound at the same time. It also specifies that visual information provided in the video should have audio description providing equal information to users that can't see the content. EN301549 deals with requirements for hardware in Chapter 8. This includes requirements targeted on hardware with speech output, like phones, for example, or audio guides. There are also requirements on the physical environment, for example, how to place an ATM in terms of floor space and the path to the machine. The requirements in this chapter ensure that all users, no matter of abilities, can use the hardware. Chapter 9 deals with web content. This is done by pointing directly to the Web Content Accessibility Guidelines, or WCAG 2.0 Level AA. The Web Content Accessibility Guidelines were created by the World Wide Web Consortium in 2008. These guidelines are the common denominator for much of what is done in accessibility in the web-based domain. They are quite complex, but if you are dealing with the web, you probably already know them. And if you don't, you definitely should. We have made an entire video about them. For now, it's enough to know that there are a total of 61 success criteria in WCAG, and that 38 of these need to be met if you want to comply with level AA, which is what the EN301549 requires. A success criterion in WCAG is a measurable requirement that is technology independent. This means that it can be used regardless of what technology you're using. It is as relevant for HTML as it is for documents in different formats or any other web technology you are using. Annex A is a copy of Web Content Accessibility Guidelines 2.0. Since the WCAG is a separate set of guidelines, this annex is only informative. But you still need to meet the success criteria in WCAG to meet the requirements of Chapter 9 in EN301549. This means you really need to get to know the WCAG guidelines if you have an ICT product or service with any kind of web content, document, or software that the user gets in contact with, including documentation and help surrounding the actual product or service. To really make a web-based interface accessible, you might need to include more requirements than the success criteria in WCAG. And you might need to specify how some of these success criteria should be met to avoid misinterpretations and mistakes. WCAG is also used in Chapter 10 in the EN standard. Chapter 10 covers non-web documents. Although much of WCAG is relevant for documents outside of the web, some success criteria are not relevant. In the EN standard, there is a table to help you understand how to use WCAG in the context of non-web documents. Chapter 11 deals with non-web software. This could be software in a check-in machine at an airport, or a vending machine, or any hardware with a user interface. Also for non-web software, WCAG is used as a base. So in this chapter, you will find a table explaining how to use WCAG in a non-web context. But there are other requirements as well. Requirements to ensure that the software can be used with assistive technology, or that it caters for the user needs in other ways to make it possible to use the service. One important thing here is that there are also some requirements on authoring tools. If you have a software where users can create content for other users, these authoring tools need to be accessible, and the output from these tools need to be accessible as well. In that way, the content remains accessible. To meet the requirements of the EN standard, it's not enough that the service in itself is accessible. The documentation and support services also need to be accessible. This is covered in Chapter 12. Support services could, among other things, be help desks, call centers, and training services. In reality, what this chapter says is that documentation and support services need to follow the requirements in the other chapters of EN 301-549. The last chapter in the standard, Chapter 13, covers relay and emergency services. Relay service makes it possible for individuals with different communication abilities to communicate with each other remotely using ICT for text, sign language, or lip reading. This chapter covers requirements on how to provide conversion between modes of communication, normally by a human operator. Now we have gone through all the chapters of the EN 301-549. There is one video for each chapter if you want more details. Of course, not all requirements are relevant in all procurement situations, so you need to pick the requirements that apply to your situation. But there's even more to it. The standard also contains three annexes to help you understand the requirements. We have already talked about Annex A and Annex B. In Annex C, you will find information on how to verify compliance with the requirements. Note that this annex is quite complex and that the actual testing requires a lot of skills and experience. Like every other profession, you need training and experience to work with accessibility. If you don't have that training or experience, you need to involve experts. So, that's it for this video. Hopefully, you have a general understanding of the structure of the EN 301-549 and what's in there. If you would like to know more, there's one video for each chapter in the standard. Thanks for watching.